afternoon. Well, good afternoon once again, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this opening plenary, the voice of business in trade policy. Before I continue, yeah, you can raise the volume, it's okay. Before I continue, I'd like to ask those in the room, anyone who's a first-time visitor to Nairobi, first time. Oh, wow, we've got a bunch. Welcome to Nairobi, folks. If you want to know about some of the sights and sounds, talk to me afterwards. I can recommend a few great places, including one with my name on it, the street with my name on it. But that's a discussion for later on, not now. Once again, the Nairobi Trade and Business Forum, organized in collaboration with Trademark East Africa and the International Chamber of Commerce. That's the other ICC, in case you're wondering. It's providing a platform for closer engagement between business and policymakers. This is what we want to do this afternoon. I've got a fantastic panel of guests with me today. I'm going to ask a bunch of questions, and I would urge you, members of the audience, to also ask them questions, because you are not going to be able to engage with people like this in a forum like this. Believe me when I tell you, a great panel of experts who will be coming on stage momentarily. Now, since this is the day and age of the digital generation, I'd like to urge you all to tweet, those of you who can, who are. The Twitter handle is at ICTSD, at ICTSD, India Charlie Tango Sierra Delta. And the hashtag we're using all day and throughout the rest of the week is TDS Nairobi. TDS Nairobi. Of course, if you copy me on your tweets at Koinanga Jeff, I'll be sure to retweet to all 680,000 of my followers. If I retweet that once or twice, it goes viral. So please, at Koinanga Jeff, don't forget, okay? Thank you very much. So, well, thank you, Mark. Now, the two thematic themes and streams which will unfold here with the Nairobi Trade and Business Forum is the voice of business, which we all talk about, the voice of business, and of course, the focus on Africa. Everybody has been looking towards Africa like it's the next best thing. Why? What's it like working in Africa, trading in Africa? What are the challenges? What are the hurdles? How does business interact with policymakers? That's what we want to discuss tonight. So, without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, and again, I urge you all, when it comes to Q&A time, raise your hand. When you get the mic, tell us who you are, where you're from, and please ask your question. Keep it short and to the point, okay? Now, in case you're wondering, who is this noisemaker on stage? And for those of you visitors to Nairobi, my name is Jeff Koinange, and I will be your traffic cop for most of the afternoon. So no chewing gum while I'm here. I'm kidding. Let's just have a good time. So first up, ladies and gentlemen, young man, he's only barely 40 years old, and the kinds of jobs this man has held is incredible. He was at the European Directorate General for Trade and at the European Commission, the Swedish National Board of Trade, Special Advisor to the Minister of Industry and Trade. I mean, this guy has done it all, so he knows a thing or two about policy. Please put your hands together for the Deputy Secretary General of the United Nations Conference on Trade and Development, a.k.a. UNCTAD, Joachim Reiter. Next up, a gentleman who's been a financial director for a long time in a group which many of you will come to know as one of the leading ones, because they started off tiny, small here in Kenya and have grown to 25 units around the world, 19 of them in Africa. They call it TechnoBrain. That's the name of the company. He'll tell us more about it. Please welcome the finance director, David Irungu. Up next, a good friend of mine, he's been in the banking business for, well, I don't want to tell you how long, but it's been long. And he's been working around the continent in various stages. And now he's managing director, chief executive officer of Standard Chartered Bank Kenya, as opposed to Standard Bank. You know, they always get, it's always confusing. Please welcome Lamine Manjang. Next up, He's worked at the Paris-based International Chamber of Commerce. He is the Executive Director of the Department of Policy and Business Practices. Please put your hands together for Stefano Bertazzi. Did I pronounce that right, Stefano? Was it Bertazzi?
Very good.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Up next, this man is on more boards than one can put a finger to. I'm telling you, it's incredible. He's chairman of the board of Msingi Limited, Legacy Capital Partners, Trademark East Africa, Chai Bora, on and on and on. He comes from the land where we've been talking about the last few weeks. We keep asking ourselves, what would Magufuli do? I want to know what Ali Mufuruki would do. Ladies and gentlemen, Ali Mufuruki. We're actually waiting for the Zambian Minister of Trade and Commerce, who should be arriving very shortly. But before she comes, or while we wait, let's just kick it. Let's just get underway. Ali, you were last on, so you're first up. Tell us just a little bit about what you do, Ali, just so that people here could be familiar, and maybe you can explain why you're on like 35 boards in one. I mean, aren't there any Tanzanians? Aren't there enough people? Tell us a little bit about what you do. Is the mic working, Ali?
Thank you, Jeff, for the generous introduction. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm lucky in the sense that I'm told the audience hasn't changed much this afternoon. Before this panel, my CEO was speaking, Frank Massa, the CEO of Trademark East Africa. What's the capacity of the chat? Yeah, to talk about East Africa and its place and region, integration, and all issues, trade. Now, because I know Frank's capacity to tell our story, the story of East Africa, I'm not going to bore you with that again. Instead, of Africa in global trade, and what conferences like this, important as they are, mean for us. Because I was asking myself, when you spoke, right here, I sit on a lot of boards, and I know that you don't just sit on the board because you are a human being or because you live somewhere near where action is happening, you have to earn the right to be there. So I asked myself, what right did Africa then to be invited to any WTO negotiation now, given that Africa's share of global trade is so small?
Who really cares about somebody whose contribution to what's happening is less than 2%? Who cares about what they have to say? What do you have to offer? Negotiations about give and take. What are you able to give? Or are you just here to take? And I was thinking that it would be really useful to spend the next few days, especially for the Africans in this room and those in other places who are going to be coming here, to spend more time talking to each other about what it's going to take for before Africa can be taken seriously in conversations about global trade.
Because honestly, we cannot be just claiming for or asking for a seat at the table when our contribution is completely absent. We cannot be asking just because we are part of humanity, because we are human beings, because we are human people, because we occupy 25% of the land that got created for mankind. We have to contribute in order to be able to ask for fairness, for justice in trade. Because otherwise it's difficult. When you contribute only 2% and you're asking for fairness in pricing of the goods, you're asking for fairness in the cost of transportation, but you don't contribute to the ownership of any of that transportation infrastructure. You're asking for fairness in interest rates, but you don't contribute in the accumulation of that capital that's been shared around. You're asking for fairness in everything, but you're giving nothing. So I think that instead of worrying too much about whether trade is fair today, Africa needs to worry about what it can do to increase its production to make it commensurate with the numbers of Africans that occupy this planet. There's close to a billion of us, I think in excess of a billion. We should be contributing, in all fairness, no less than 50% of the world's GDP. We contribute far too little. So all this talk about trade is unfair, prices are too high, interest is too high for Africans, is going to remain just a conversation about claim for pity, for sympathy, but I think it's not going to be a negotiation. I want to leave that with you. We can have a conversation after this. Thank you. Thank you.
Well put, Ali, very well put. And you know, we're not asking for handouts anymore, by the way, Ali. We're not asking for handouts, and we're not asking for sympathy.
That's what you're saying. All right. So, Joachim Reiter, I like to think of what's happening in Africa as a new kind of industrial revolution. It's not like 200, 300 years ago. There's a new kind of industrial revolution, new generation of services, new generation of industries. How can trade policy committees at the multilateral level, how can they help us even the playing field, if you will?
I really like the question, by the way, if I may. But when you start, let's start from the basics. How big of a challenge is Africa facing? Because Africa is populating most of the LDCs, so they're here. Poverty, although Africa is rising, is still a huge problem, and now we have committed to eradicate it. What we have calculated, and this is a rather daunting task, is that basically the least developed countries that we, as we know them, will have to beat China's growth rate for the next 15 years. So if you're navigating along a map and you think you're going to keep that map that you've had until now, my suggestion is forget it. Get a new map. It will be a map that will be both nationally, as well as regionally, as well as multilaterally. By the way, I come from a small country. I've never had a problem complaining about bigger countries, although my contribution is very limited. But I do think you have a really strong point in the sense of all these three levels have to work in tandem. Multilateralism have to make its contribution, for which also, and ultimately when we talk about WTO negotiation, is member-driven. You know, when I was a Swedish delegate and going to NGO rallies, I often got the question whether we should dismantle the WTO because it's not delivering. And the answer is, well, if you want to dismantle something, dismantle some of the members because they're preventing the progress. So if you're serious about agriculture subsidies, well, name the countries that are preventing the progress. Tackle them. It is not the WTO in itself that is failing. It's members failing to make use of the vehicle that our WTO offers to actually create a better planet and better prosperity for all. So that's what you have to do, and there's a huge homework to be done in WTO. Unfortunately, we're not getting to the real issues because we're stuck on, you know, deadlocks that have been protracted for a very, very long time.
Is that why Africans get discouraged at some point? They get so discouraged because there's so many hurdles.
Well, life is tough. I mean, of course there are many hurdles, but it's complicated to live a life, and it's complicated to do negotiations, particularly with 162. But I do need you to think that in terms of creating this map, it's no point in putting all the eggs in the multilateral basket. There's no point in putting all the eggs in a national regional basket either. These three things have to come together. Now, you asked me about Africa rising. Well, despite the huge challenge, there are a number of positive signs in Africa. Actually, in 34 out of the African countries, services is now driving growth. Services. I mean, if you Google Africa, you get these pictures on Google. They're basically wrong. They don't depict the right Africa from the point of view of the growth perspective. But it is true from the point of industrial transformation, which is the key for development as well. It is true that Africa, in terms of FDI stock, only had 21% in manufacturing. Much remains to be done to unleash the industrial transformation of Africa. Services is picking up. My argument would be it's probably picking up more due to private sector and not thanks to policymakers. So it's the private sector that drives this development. Policies, if anything, has inhibited or not helped enough to unleash the services miracle. And this is where the homework at the national and the regional level has to come together with the multilateral level.
Thank you. Well done. Good. Well put. And I like that. Get a new map. Bottom line, right?
Yes.
As if you can read a map, but I don't know about GPS. Okay. So Lamin Manjang, I think Joachim pointed to you when he talked about private sector. You've worked for a bank that's 150 years old. I'm not saying you've worked for them that long, but I'm just saying. But a 150-year-old bank adapting to the 21st century. And this Africa Rising that everybody talks about, is that a myth or is that a reality?
All right. Thanks, Jeff. And good afternoon. Yes, you're right. I've not worked for the bank for 150 years. Just drop one zero there, and that's the time that I've worked for the Standard Chartered Bank. You're right. We are the oldest bank in many countries in Africa, including here in Kenya. And in terms of our footprint, we cover Africa, Asia, and the Middle East, despite being a British bank headquartered in the UK. I think one of the things that we have seen is the way trade patterns have changed in Africa. Africa used to historically trade with Europe. That was our historical trade partner. Now we have seen that trade corridor shift to Asia and to the Middle East, particularly China. I just read a very interesting statistic that trade with China in 1950, Africa trade with China, was just $12 million. In 2014, that had risen to $220 billion. Now, that's phenomenal. Europe is still the main trading partner with Africa in total, but I think it's shifting now towards towards Asia. And, of course, the Middle East as well. Banking is very critical to facilitate trade. I mean, the bank, Standard Chartered, started, and it was really a trade bank, and it has continued to facilitate trade. I think when we talk about regional integration, when you talk about trade, it can't happen without the financial sector. The financial sector is a very critical driver of that trade happening. And this is really where Standard Chartered plays a very critical role. The interesting point about private sector sometimes being ahead of policy, I think Kenya has a very interesting example of that. For those of you who have just been to Kenya recently, I'm sure you've heard of M-Pesa. It's the mobile payment platform that was developed by Safaricom some years back. Africa is actually leading the world in terms of mobile payment. I was just interested when I read about Apple launching what they call Apple Pay, so that, you know, with your phone you can make a payment in the U.S. We've been doing that many years ago, so it's no innovation, you know, as far as we are concerned. So really it's an example of how the private sector has been able to take the lead. And in the case of Kenya, the good thing was that the policymakers did not stop it. They did not intervene. They didn't understand it, but they allowed it to grow, and then they followed they followed the innovation. So I think, Africa is definitely rising, and the private sector is playing a very critical role in that.
Thanks, Lamin. And I'm glad you mentioned M-Pesa. Did you understand what Lamin said about M-Pesa, those visitors? Did you understand? Mobile money? Money in your mobile phone? And for Africa, I mean, this is very important, because if you're living in Nairobi and your parents or family is living in the rural areas, you can just send them money on your phone and they go to a kiosk, registered agent, and they pick up the money in real time. And Apple say that they, you know, they're bragging about doing this recently.
Yeah.
We've been doing this for 20 years.
Not quite 20.
Okay, okay, almost, all right. David, I'm going to skip you for a moment and go to Stefano, because Lamin mentioned policy, ICC, not the International Criminal Court, but International Chamber of Commerce, deals with policy, Stefano. Do we understand or do we find the hurdles too difficult when it comes to policy, when it comes to breaking that ice?
Thank you very much. I thought you were talking about the International Cricket Council, but that's okay. No, policy is critically important. We're a global business organization. We speak for companies all over the world, across sectors, in all geographies. And we were created in 1919 to bring prosperity and peace through world trade. So I think that these lofty objectives that our founding fathers had are still very much true today. And how do we do that? We're trying to bring global business across sectors and across geographies together to construct consensus views on policies or either tools to oil the wheels of trade that we can then bring to governments. And the idea is that by creating a global business consensus around some issues, at least at the level of principle in most cases, we can inform and hopefully help governments themselves come to consensus on issues. Now, people who have been looking at the Doha round advanced by leaps and bounds for the last 40 years might say that we've not been so successful in doing that. But in fact, it's not true. There's a huge amount of, views that business share across sectors and across geographies. And to the extent that we are able as ICC to be a facilitator in putting those together to inform governments, we do that on an ongoing basis. I very much agree with Joachim, though, that although we're a global business organization and we here at the, well, me at the Secretariat in Paris and my colleagues pitch our views to the IGOs and their members, the Secretariat, it's increasingly important to engage the regional actors. So, you know, you've got interesting policy developments and novel policy approaches in regional entities that are newer and that take different ways to doing this. I guess that one interesting thing is this integration that the African Union has tried to build here in Africa, and there are other examples in other parts of the world, such as APEC, for example. And obviously, the national level matters a great deal. And why is that? Well, the reason is for the reason Joachim said. At the end of the day, the WTO is a collection of 163 national governments. So unless you're able to convince the members of the merits of doing something, or a sufficient number of them, you're not going to get very far. So we have to carry our message to all those three levels, and that's absolutely important. I would say that for us, really, as a global business organization, there is a need, if business is going to be able to operate globally and trade and invest across borders and work on the basis of this new way of working, which are global and regional value chains, there is a need for policy consolidation, coherence, certainty at the global level. And this is why an effective and vibrant multilateral trading system, not in isolation by itself without other elements, as I said before, at regional level or at national level in terms of domestic policy reform, but we absolutely need that very strong pillar of a multilateral set of rules. And this is why what hopefully will be going on from tomorrow afternoon in the convention center across the road is so important to us, and this is why we're here.
Excellent stuff. And real quick, I'm going to talk to you in a bit. Just think about this. You talked about involving yourselves with regional bodies, so the African Union Commission, the East African Community, and there's been talk about intra-Africa trade. Hold that thought, think about it for a moment. As I skip back to David Irungu, techno brain. Obviously, when you guys first started in 1997, nearly 20 years ago, you didn't think you'd end up two decades later in 25 countries globally, 19 of them in Africa. Tell us a little bit about techno brain, real quick, and what the biggest setback or the biggest challenge has been in working across the continent.
So thank you, Jeff. So TechnoBrain, obviously, as we speak about all the other organizations here, we are speaking about household names. But TechnoBrain is something I'm sure most people seated in the audience here or even seated across here really don't have a very clear idea of what TechnoBrain is all about. So we are talking about, I think I'll use one word here that said, is Africa rising a myth? And it's not a myth. Because TechnoBrain represents exactly that. This is a company started in Africa in 1997, and today this is a company that is employing more than 1,600 people. Started in Tanzania 3 years ago, moved to Nairobi as the headquarters. We are talking about 1,400 people employed in Africa, and they're not employed in any kind of jobs. They are employed in skilled jobs. So, we are talking about the number of people who've been trained by TechnoBrain is 500,000 plus today. And just more to Jeff's question, exactly what does TechnoBrain do? So we look at ourselves as an IT solutions company. So we are in IT solutions, meaning software, preparing software for most critical things that are needed in Africa today. We have a very unique market here where a lot of African governments are still struggling with collection of revenue, for example, to facilitate so that in Kenya, for example, instead of keeping talking about budget deficits, we are able to use technology to make sure we can actually collect the money that we should be collecting. Then we are talking about training our people in high skills, world-class technology. TechnoBrain is doing exactly that. Today, we've set up a development center in Nairobi. We are not just talking about people going to do business so that the company can make money. We are talking about building skills for Africa and making sure the solutions that we are offering to African governments are actually African-made for Africa. They are not solutions that were created out there for a different market. We are creating solutions for Africa. And then the business process outsourcing, which we are also doing in a big way. We know today in the world, I'm sure if I ask about business process outsourcing, a lot of people will say, oh, Bangalore, India. If you talk about systems development, you say Hyderabad, India. Yeah. We are making exactly that happen in Africa. And this is Kenya. So not just Kenya, we are in 19 countries today. So more to Jeff's question again, what challenges are we facing? As an African company, we obviously don't enjoy the same big brother, big mother out there who can then keep providing the capital that we need to invest. We have to look for that money here. We don't have foreign investors. We are doing it from here. We are doing it from home. So the biggest challenge, I would say, think about cost of financing in Africa. If you're not coming from a multinational who can source funding in a much cheaper way, I know Ali and Joachim probably mentioned about whining about high cost of finance. So we are not whining. We are saying we need to be involved in trade policy. We need to be involved in policies by the government. We need to work together to make sure capital is more affordable in Africa. That's the only way we can build Africa and not just wait for anybody else out there to come and do it for us. We talked about negotiations. Negotiations, when we go for these negotiations, like in this particular symposium, which is happening here this week, let's remember, it's negotiations. Everybody is here for their own stake. So let's go for it for our own stake. Let's not go there and hope somebody is looking up for us. No, we go there and negotiate as equal partners.
David, real quick, a lot of people have complained about how difficult it is doing business in Africa. Has it been for you all, Africans, doing business in Africa?
Yes, it has been. And like you say, already, you need to tender for jobs because mainly we are servicing governments. We are servicing central governments. We are servicing county governments in Kenya, and we are servicing provinces and all that type of regions in other African countries. So when you tender, you are actually competing against other companies, multinational companies that are sourcing funding in an easier way, there's still a perception of people from this region will do it better. But we represent Africa. We say we are bringing same world-class technology that can be used in Africa for Africa. But it has been difficult because of those stereotypes. And those are the stereotypes we need to fight and keep influencing the policymakers so that all African countries can have the same footing as any other.
Great, David, hold that thought. That's really well put, because you know, we always complain about stuff that's made in China. We complain. We're still buying it. We're still buying it, right? Is it because it's forget it. Okay. Tweets coming in thick and fast. I'll read a couple of them just now. Just to remind you, the Twitter handle is @ICTSD. @ICTSD. The hashtag we're using today is TDS Nairobi. So Ruth Wanja, if you're here or wherever you are, he said, and who said trade is boring? Talk of money, business, integration, sustainable development goals. This is where it's happening. Thank you, Ruth. Faith Kamena says, great and mighty business symposium. Peter Bay Kickard. Oh, you say, lively intro by Kwenanga Jeff for plenary debate. Thank you, Peter, wherever you are. Thank you. Vanessa Waitito is echoing what Joachim said. Get a new map. I like that. Jerry Gishoro says, Africa has great opportunities in trade trajectory. There are hurdles, and those can be tackled. Okay, let me read a couple of new tweet questions for David. No, for Ali and Lamin. And Lamin, you mentioned M-Pesa being the thing that everybody talks about. Someone is tweeting asking, what is the next big thing? And Ali, you can jump in there as well. What's the next big thing that's going to blow this continent out of the water? Not literally, but, you know.
Well, Jeff, I think if I was going to predict, it still got to be in the digital space. As a bank, for instance, we have realized that the future of banking is not going to lie in bricks and mortar. So the idea of opening more and more branches across our footprint is not really going to be the way banking is going to be conducted. We see more and more people using their mobile phone to do more and more things on the mobile phone. So I think the fact that Africa has leapfrogged in terms of that technological revolution, in terms of using the mobile, I think that is the next big thing. Now, in terms of how further this will evolve, it's yet to be seen. But clearly, I think the digital revolution is still got a long way to go.
Yeah. Ali, you want to chip in there?
Jeff, I don't know. Is this the same broken mic?
What would Magufuli do?
I think it's quite interesting and maybe also difficult living in Africa because you get asked a question like this, what's the next big thing? As if we've had a big thing already. And you don't want to get me started with the Africa rising thing because I don't think Africa is rising. And I've said that, made that provocative statement about a year ago. And of the more than 30,000 people who have bothered to engage with me on this, only 6 have disagreed with me. So I think that we need to really re-examine that narrative. I want to get back to, I mean, M-Pesa. M-Pesa is funny, it's interesting, it's a great innovation, but there's a big difference between wiring money and making money. You know what I mean? Wiring money and making money. We need to ask ourselves, are we making money in Africa? Are we making enough money in Africa? If so, why is our share of global trade so small? Why is it not growing? As a matter of fact, it has dropped. Now, for me, the next big thing that I would have wanted to see happen in Africa is Africa becoming self-sufficient in food production. Although most of our people are engaged in food production on an everyday basis, that's all they do, Africa still imports 83% of its food. 83%. If we are importing 83% of what we need to eat, and most times we don't have the money to buy that food, we have to go, first of all, we worry about food price because we are importing, and then we don't have the money, we go and borrow money, then we worry about the cost of money because we don't have money. Then we worry about the cost of transportation because we don't own the transportation infrastructure. Everything we worry about, everything we ask for others to help finance. The next big thing for me would be the easiest thing to do is for Africa to become self-sufficient in food production. Now, when it comes to intra-regional trade, trade Mark East Africa, as Frank may have told you, is investing more than $500 million over the last 5 years trying to ease trade across East Africa alone. Now, it's well and good for traders in Rwanda to complain about the cost of transportation. They are being charged in Tanzania being 3 times what it is in Rwanda, and we can talk about that and we can fix that. And we have fixed it. But we don't talk enough, in my opinion, about the fact that all the containers that are being transported on African roads contain foreign manufactured goods, most times. Of the 10 containers that move west from Mombasa and Dar es Salaam, 80% return empty. So if this is the kind of trade we want to grow in Africa, I don't think that 50 years from now we'll have made lots of progress. We need to be able to fill those containers. We need to be able to increase our output so that we can strengthen our negotiating teams when they come to negotiate at symposiums like this. The next big thing would be for Africa to produce more. I don't know if it's going to happen.
It's a good point. Very good point, Ali. Does that mean you all agree with what Ali just said? He just slammed the whole continent in like 3 minutes. You agree with him? You want to put your hand up and add to this? Or does anybody disagree? You disagree? Is there a microphone near you? Is there a mic back there? Here, Deborah, give him a mic. And just keep it short and sweet, okay? If you disagree back there, behind the pillar. Excuse
me. I would tend to disagree.
Tell us your name, please, if you don't mind.
Murabo Odari. I'm a Pan-Africanist. And I'm also way younger than himself. So the thing is, he's talking about very reasonable things. But the fundamental is that Africa has made a lot of progress over time. Yes? And for us to grow the way you're talking, we need to reinvent our definition of poverty, our definition of development, and our definition of currency. We cannot be using somebody else's map to determine our destination. So you're looking from another person's perspective of what is growth, of what is better, of what is good, and you're using it to judge a whole continent. And for that, a faster rat is still a rat. So we are growing in the sense that we are redefining our thought processes. When you're talking about transfer of money, to you it may not be an issue. To that lady in the village whose son sent 1,000 shillings for her to be able to start a small process, that is a livelihood. So let us not look at things from definitions we have borrowed. Let us start reinventing our own understandings. So to that point, I do disagree with him.
Murago, how old are you, if I may ask?
I am 26.
26. Okay, yes. Ali, you hear that? That's the voice of a whole new generation. And Africa, 3/4 of Africa is that age. Well done, Murago. Well done. Joachim, do you agree with this? Do you agree reinventing our thought processes? I mean, there's a whole new generation that may not agree with what Ali is saying. It could be true. It could be blunt when he says this. Reinventing.
Frankly, I think Stefano and I are the two persons in the panel who shouldn't comment on the definition of Africa.
I said it deliberately.
And I'd be very careful about that. But there are some basic facts which Ali said, which I think is worth repeating. Finally, we live in a world where everyone is getting smaller. That's the fundamental effect of globalization. That fits perfectly if you're small from the beginning. Like my country never had the idea that it would dominate and control things. So we're small, and it's just being edgy and fast. Now, on top of it, I come from a country with an Arctic climate, which basically means that it costs a hell of a lot to get the mining, the iron ore from the mines up north to the harbor in Gothenburg to transport it out. And our competitors in the history of my country actually had much more proximity from the mines to the harbors. That's why my country came to the conclusion the only way to beat them, and it is a competition, was actually to slash trade cost. The whole Bali achievement on trade facilitation actually started with a bunch of businessmen being incredibly annoyed with the Swedish government and drawing up a list of actions for them to cut trade cost. In the end, you have two costs. You have the cost of production and you have the cost of trade. Now, I see a lot of things going for Africa on the cost of production, provided, of course, the doing business can improve. My big fear is on the cost of trade. The average cost of taking a container out of Africa, the export, even though a lot of them are empty, is double that of OECD countries. This has to change. And one of the ways to do that is regional integration. That's why I, at least from an UNCTAD point of view, we are incredibly staunch supporters of the attempts in Africa to be serious about regional integration, including on a continental basis. You need to build the value chains between neighboring countries in Africa so as to be productive and competitive enough
to link up and climb the global value chains, to get the value added in Africa, as opposed to relying on the consumer goods coming from third countries, be it Asia or Europe or wherever it comes from. So the way I see it is that in terms of the cost of production and in terms of demographic dividends, you have a lot of going for yourself. The big question mark from the point of view of industrialization, at least the way I see it from UNCTAD's point of view, which deals with advising governments on how to become competitive, including in the regulatory environment, competition policy, e-regulation, investment policies. But there is the question also then of the region integration. And there you have the ambitions now, but you need to translate it into concrete actions. Mm. Much like, by the way, this is not revolutionary, much like this is what basic European integration was about. In the 80s, it was incredibly difficult to put a product from Germany into the market of France. That's what the Single Market Act was all about, to make sure that there were regulatory convergence and harmony between different regulations between different countries in Europe. The regulatory divergence in Africa is very high. That slaps costs on business. And this is where businessmen will have to tell policymakers, enough is enough. We are prepared to stand up and fight in the global competition, but you need to make it possible for us to compete in a globalized market. And for that, you need to deal with the trade cost. And that is government-induced trade cost, by and large.
And let's face it, Joachim, not every country in Europe has embraced European Union. Not every, I mean.
Nope.
Right?
Including the country I live in, which is Switzerland.
There you go. Yeah. You still have the currency, right?
Well, I come from Sweden, which on top of it is no part of Europe, so.
Stefano, Joachim talked about regional integration. We talk about East African Community, ECOWAS, SADC, COMESA. And for a long time, countries were fighting not to be a part of these. It was a big struggle. I'm sure Ali could tell us. It was a huge struggle. Finally, it looks like it's falling in place, but it's taken a while, hasn't it?
It has, and regional integration is moving in some regions faster than it is in others. But as Joachim said, I wouldn't want to judge as an outsider's perspective what's going on here. But I think definitely the ambition of creating this common market by 2017 is a very laudable one. And again, I think this whole issue about trade costs and trade facilitation shows how what happens domestically is relevant to what happens regionally is relevant to what happens multilaterally. If you look at the multilateral level, starting from there, the WTO in 1996, at the first ministerial conference of the WTO in Singapore, my organization militated very strongly for putting trade facilitation on the agenda of the WTO. Trade facilitation was regarded as this sort of very technical, boring thing that had to do with, paperwork and customs red tape and not worthy of the World Trade Organization. But we managed to convince the powers that be that they needed to look at this. And lo and behold, in 2013 in Bali, the members of the WTO, 161 of them, I think, at the time, managed to come up with a multilateral agreement to facilitate trade, to simplify trade procedures, customs procedures, policies, mainly about 80-85% of the content of that agreement is very sort of nitty-gritty basic stuff that customs administrations can do. And by the way, the organization is in a race to ratify this agreement so that it come into force, and I think this country was the last one to ratify it late last week. We've got 57 countries, I think, WTO members that ratified it. We need 108. That process would follow its course, and we will be pushing very strongly for it to come to fruition as soon as possible. But the important thing is customs administrations, countries, trade ministries can implement this as of today. And they are already. There are previous rules. There's a Kyoto Convention in the customs ambit that picks up most of this stuff. And this is very practical, doable stuff. So in terms of reducing trade costs for Africa, especially where they tend to be higher than elsewhere, implementing the trade facilitation agreement is a very important thing. Regional integration will facilitate that because it's another layer where trade costs between African countries can be reduced. And then domestically, you have to look at the domestic policy environment and see where barriers at the border need to be reduced. And that will be done through multilateral trade liberalization, but also regional trade liberalization. And I think you also need to look at regulatory reform because most of the barriers to trade now don't come necessarily from a barrier that is slapped on at the border, but they come from barriers that have to do with the domestic regulatory environment, and there are barriers domestically beyond the border. And that especially affects trade in services, and services is the fastest part of the fastest growing part of economies all over the world, including on this continent. And this continent is growing, by the way. It's one of the few continents in the world that can say that, and it does have some very very good things going for it, despite the very serious challenges that it needs to meet.
So Ali, you know, just slamming us a few minutes ago, this African rising, it is rising, Stefano?
Look, it's not for me to judge.
Yes, but it is for you. You're here, okay?
I'm here, but I can say that it's making progress, and it has challenges that it needs to overcome.
What
for
a
sure.
diplomatic answer from Stefano. Goodness. Good answer, though. Good answer. David Irungu, Stefano talked about intra-Africa trade. You're in 19 countries in Africa. Language is always a factor. Anglophone Africa, Francophone Africa, Lusophone Africa. Has it been challenging for you guys? Is language still a problem?
And actually, Jeff, in our case, I would say not so much, because what has happened is our company is mainly in Anglo-speaking Africa. We ventured a little into the French territory, but not in a big way. We are in Mozambique, though, where it's Portuguese, but by and large, not in a big way.
And you didn't go to Francophone because you were afraid.
Exactly. Yeah. But if you don't mind, Jeff, I would like to add more probably to the previous topic. Mm-hmm. And what I want to say is this, as an African, and looking at whether we can make more money, whether we can produce more, whether we can bring down cost of business, for me, it simply go back to the basics. So how can we expect to do that when you come to Nairobi and many parts of Nairobi, you are not even sure whether you can get water, basic as it is. So for me, I think we need to set policies at the top that drive these countries, not just Kenya. We are talking about the whole of Africa. We need to drive very basic policies that provide the basics that make development happen. It doesn't just happen. We don't just start producing a lot of goods if we have no roads, we have no electricity. So we need to really go for these. We need to have a very predictable system of government. Today, when I apply for a business registration, it's actually a guess. When will it come out? We need to have clear laws saying you apply today, you meet the requirements, and in 2 months, it's out. And if it's not out, you have an answer why it's not out. So it's very basic things that we need to do, and we don't need to. I'm not going to preach doom. I'm going to preach that it's possible, and it's possible by us, not by anybody else.
David, at the same time, the countries like Rwanda, if you apply for their business license, you would get it possibly in 24 hours or less. Is that the way it is?
Yeah, very true, Jeff. And so, as Africans, we need to learn from our own brothers here. Rwanda has made a lot of progress, and I believe all the other countries are capable of doing exactly the same. Mm. Who among us wouldn't want an environment that works? All of us would like that. So why don't we drive it?
Ali, you mentioned self-sufficiency in food production, the basics. The question I guess one would ask is, are we leapfrogging? Are we just going way ahead of ourselves just because we have 3G and 4G in some places? We think that the playing field has been leveled?
Look, I'm not going to push this.
Push, please, push.
Since you keep talking about, tell us, I'm slamming the continent. It's not fair. There are great things happening. It's just that for me, they are not enough. I want to see a transformed Africa in my lifetime. And I'm not as old as that young man thinks. So I really would like to see something happen in my lifetime. And I don't see it happening if we continue along this trajectory. We get distracted by stuff like, oh, we are the most connected. We are the most connected continent in the whole world. Nobody asks how much it costs to call in Africa. We may be the most connected, but compare it to the United States, which has the most, you know, old-fashioned phone networks, but they have the cheapest phone calls in the whole world. So it's not just about being connected. It may have transformed the lives of people. I hear people saying, oh, now we have rural electrification, we're using solar in villages and so on. For me, when I go back to the village, I can see how life has been transformed. I used to live in the village. I never knew light at night. It was always pitch dark. But today, kids can switch on light. There's that one bulb by solar, and they can read at night. It's a great transformation for them. But it's not going to transform life in the village, because that electricity doesn't power industries. We are talking about industrialization, but we cannot build industries in rural areas because there is no grid there. There's light. There's no development. Light is not exactly the same thing as development. It is progress, but we are still very far behind the rest of the world. So I think that what I'm saying is Africans need to become more ambitious. They need to demand more. 6% is not enough. 8% is not enough. 15% may not be enough. If China at its peak was drawing at 18% in this 1 billion people, why would you want to call 6% growth commendable? So I think that we do have a problem here of being satisfied with too little. Time is not on our side. The world is moving ahead. When you are 1 billion people, 15% of the world's population, and you command less than 2% of global trade, less than 3% of FDIs, and you say you are making progress and you're happy, then I see a problem. That's all I'm saying.
You guys seem to agree with a lot of what Ali is saying, huh?
All right, okay.
Lamine, is the problem leadership then? Is it leadership? Is it lack of vision? What is it?
No, I tend to agree with Ali as well. I think we have to be very careful with the syndrome of thinking small. I happen to study in Malaysia. And I remember this was in the early 80s. Dr. Mahathir Mohamad started what he called the Vision 2020. He wanted to make Malaysia a fully industrialized, developed country by the year 2020. I was there in the early 80s, and I could actually see that transformation live in front of my eyes. When I finished studies, came back to Africa, worked many years. The last time I went there was around 2007. It was a completely different country. The airport that I landed was different from the airport that was there when I was studying. In between the airport and Kuala Lumpur, a brand new capital city had been built. There was a fast speed trade from the airport to the capital city. All of that was as a result of a vision that the leader had, you know, announced in the 80s that Malaysia must be a fully industrialized developed country. Now, Malaysia happens to be a country that got independence the same year as Ghana. Ghana got independence in 1957. Malaysia got independence in 1957. Today we are talking of a fully industrialized country, when in Ghana, despite all the progress that has been made, Ghana is still, you know, a developing country. A poor country, developing country. So I think leadership is absolutely important. The potential that Africa has is massive. But I always say that the true wealth of Africa would not be what is beneath the ground. It's what is in the head. So the techno brains of this world. This is what will transform the continent. If we just rely on our natural resources and think we are wealthy, when in actual fact we are not using our human resources, which is the real wealth, then clearly, you know, we'll just be struggling behind. There is incremental progress, yes. When we say Africa rising, we are comparing it with the 70s, the 80s, when we were completely out, all right? Then in the 90s and the 2000s, we started coming up again. Yes, from that perspective, it's clearly progress. But yeah, I agree with Ali. I mean, 6-7%, which is the average growth that we are all talking about, it's not enough. It's not going to transform, and it's not going to be leapfrogging so that we are at the same level as the Malaysians, the Singapores, and so on, which we should be benchmarking against.
Great points. Great points. Thank you. Questions from the audience, please. Get your questions ready. Yep, you have a question? Okay, we'll get to you just in 1 second as you get ready, and we'll pass the mic around. David Irungu, if there was a young man, young woman in this audience who wants to be next, wants to form, wants to start the next techno brain, what's the one thing they need to do? What's the one thing?
I would say for any business, technology obviously being one of them, what you need is the passion and the clear vision of what it is that you want to do and the passion to get it done. That's all you need.
Vision, passion.
And that is what has taken TechnoBrain where it is today.
Excellent. Question from the floor there. Please tell us who you are and get to your question. Okay, here we go.
Thank you. I'm George Munga Okonji from the Civil Society, Bunge la Wazalendo. Now, in the spirit of TechnoBrain, just incidentally, you are talking about it when I had just framed up a question. Innovation and research work calls for sustainable financing. How much funding have you invested in that area? Thank you.
Investment funding, how much?
Okay, so without very specific numbers, I would say the various development centers we have output the funding as 50% of what is needed for the company goes into development. And TechnoBrain is one company, I would say in front here, so far has had organic growth, reinvested its profits. The funding from anybody out there is very little, but output it at about 50% of what we need to run the company.
How much is it worth, David?
So,
give us a number. What are you worth?
Today, the company is doing $50 million a year. So that's what we're talking about. But it's not the company in Kenya alone. Let's understand it clearly. This is a global company, like we said. So we're talking about $50 million for the whole company worldwide. It's not a big number by world standards, but again, we have to start somewhere. That's my big belief. We have to start somewhere.
Yeah. Ali, that was your bonus last year, wasn't it? Moving right along. Who else has a question? Sir, go ahead.
Thank you. Peter Kierkegaard from the Confederation of Danish Industry. I had the good fortune of being here last year with a business delegation in Kenya and Tanzania to look at what the business possibilities were here. And I think one thing that the Danish companies were talking about afterwards is that this is an extremely interesting place to invest and trade, etc. But they were a little bit discouraged maybe about investing here because of corruption and those issues. It has been mentioned here, but I think that's really a big issue for European companies, at least when trying to invest in Africa.
Good one, Peter.
What to do about that?
Well done. That's a great question. Everyone's trying to avoid it. The big C, corruption. Ali, do you have a mic there, Ali? Do you have a mic?
No, I definitely wasn't trying to avoid it. I do, part of the work I do is to advise the International Monetary Fund as part of the Africa Advisory Group. And this April, during the spring meetings, I was asked to answer a question as to what is the one thing that Africa needs to do to be able to sustain our development, especially those countries that have shown signs that they are on the development path. And so I sought to identify what I thought was the single biggest threat to Africa's development, and I said this is corruption. And because I think African countries today know the importance of macroeconomic management discipline, they know the importance of collecting taxes, they know how to manage their economies, how to manage the central banks. That is no longer a challenge. We have enough well-educated people working in all those places. And they know also the importance of the private sector playing its part. Many have embarked on a reform path, reformed their judiciaries, the financial sectors, and so on. But the one area where we seem to be lagging and failing is corruption. And why is it the single biggest threat? Because we forget maybe that we also have one of the fastest growing populations in the world. And more than half of our population, as a matter of fact, most countries today in Africa have more than 80 or somewhere around 80% of their populations are below the age of 35, are young people. Young people, most of these don't have jobs, don't have prospects, don't have good education, and they are occupying this space that we live in. When you see young people by the thousands, and some of these with university degrees in their pockets,
taking that risk of crossing that ocean there, trying to get into Europe, you have to ask yourself, what the hell is happening in Africa? And they are coming from countries where there is no war. They're coming from countries where there is no famine. But they are coming from countries where there is no opportunity for young people. And why are there no opportunities? It's because those in control, people my age, don't have a vision of creating a world after them that is going to be thriving. They are hogging the entire space, and most of the time by corrupt means. And they are insensitive to the needs of the many. So I think that is going to cause an eruption at some point. At some point, people are going to stop going north. At some point, the north is going to seal its borders, as they're trying to do. And what's going to happen, Africa is going to be in serious trouble. And all the gains we have made over the last 20, 30 years are going to be rolled back by internal discontent and possibly wars. So I really think that corruption is a problem. Obviously, corruption is affecting business today, even as we speak. And it is something that governments and business leaderships need to prioritize in terms of fighting.
Stefano, if you could just comment. Yeah, good point. Stefano, do businesses come to you at the International Chamber of Commerce and say, look, we want to do business in country X, but we don't want to deal with those people. They're so corrupt.
Well, they don't come at it like that, but they do come to us about corruption because ICC has been developing some rules to combat corruption and extortion in international business transactions since the mid-70s. So it's really something that, you know, we've been doing for quite some time because we understand, as Peter mentioned, the importance it has in you know, whether a company is going to trade or invest or make those business decisions. And if there's not the rule of law, it becomes much more complicated. It's not impossible, but it becomes much more complicated. And corruption is, you know, works at different levels. So it has to be tackled at all these levels, and we try and do that or help business navigate these different levels. There's the international global level where you do have some instruments to try and tackle corruption. So we had originally national instruments with extraterritorial reach, like US laws, then that mutated into an OECD convention, and now we have the UN Convention Against Corruption, which is a truly international instrument, which, you know, any country can sign up to, that creates a framework and principles that are useful in, setting some parameters and a framework within which national laws and other elements can be created. And then there's obviously the rule of law nationally, but there's an important role that businesses can play in this, in trying to complement the legal regime with some compliance programs. And this is why we have developed a whole suite of voluntary rules to combat corruption that deal with all sorts of issues like gifts and hospitality, how SMEs are to do due diligence to hire intermediaries or third parties in business transactions. So very concrete, practical things that we help companies with, and that's how you really combat corruption, because corruption at the end of the day becomes something very tangible. And again, you know, linking these issues that we've been talking about, trade facilitation and introducing electronic systems and IT systems to manage customs procedures and policies, that removes opportunities for corruptions that can have a really deleterious effect on the capacity of countries to attract trade and investment.
Good point. Thank you, sir. Go ahead.
Hello. My name is Mustafa Otieno, political scientist. My question goes, Africa needs to move from African, from growth to African transformation. I want to ask the panel, how do we integrate, how do we move to the next level in terms of infrastructure? Yeah. Question number two, how do we bring the youth, integrate the youth? Because the thing is that the growth is not being felt. It's so marginal. It's not being felt in the ground. So we need to move from African, from growth to transformation. How do we integrate the youth in this process? Thank you.
Lamine, you want to take that? Let's talk about the youth first. We haven't quite mentioned them too much or enough this afternoon. The youth, trickle down, if you will.
All right. Before we talk about the youth, I think he mentioned something very important, which is infrastructure. That we actually need to tackle the infrastructure challenge in Africa. And I'll just focus on one particular one, which is energy. There is one statistic which always strikes me, that the installed capacity in Nigeria, energy, is about 4,000 megawatts. 4,000 megawatts. Now that is about the same size as they said Narita Airport in Japan. Now for a country the size of Nigeria, a population of 160 million, and relying on 4,000 megawatts, that is a joke. And that is the kind of challenge that Africa has to face. And you know, it cuts across many countries. Here in Kenya, we're just slightly above 2,000 megawatts. We have a plan to reach 5,000 megawatts. But still, in the scheme of things, that is really not enough. So infrastructure, especially energy, is very, very critical. And right now, there is definitely a lot of focus across many African countries. If you look at the budgets of many African countries today, number one spending in the budget is infrastructure. But still, the gap is massive, and it will take a long time to actually achieve that. But going back to the issue of corruption, I think corruption is a challenge across the globe, so it's not a uniquely African challenge. But I think Africa can least afford it. There's always this funny story, and it's not really funny, but you know, about a minister in Africa who visited his counterpart in Malaysia. And, he invited him to his house. It was a very nice house, very posh. And he said, wow, my friend, you seem to be doing very well. Huh? I mean, what a nice house. So the minister pointed to a bridge. And he said, you see that bridge over there? 10%. 10%. All right? So a year or two later, the visit is reciprocated. The Malaysian minister now comes to the African minister and visits him, and he invites him to his house, and he sees a very, very fabulous house. Fantastic, you know, residence, pools and everything. He says, wow, my friend, you are doing very well indeed. How did you manage this? So he points at the window and he says, you see that bridge over there? The Malaysian minister looks and says, what bridge? I don't see a bridge. He says, 100%. And that is the nature of the corruption that is really devastating and destructive. When a contract is given and somebody decides to take the entire money and disappears, and there's nothing to show for it, that is very, very destructive corruption. Now, I think Africa, we do have some good examples. I think just next door to us, there's a country called Rwanda, for those of you who haven't heard about it. It has one of the, in terms of the transparency index, it ranks one of the highest in Africa. Leadership is absolutely important to combat corruption, because leadership will set the tone. Tanzania, they've just elected a new president just less than a month ago. And already the tone is changing in terms of, you know, what is tolerable, what is not acceptable, and basically setting the tone. That is the challenge. We have to have good leadership. We have to build institutions that can, you know, be able to, withstand this, stress of corruption. And also there is a giver and a taker. Sometimes we are only, you know, looking at the taker and, you know, basically criticizing them. There are givers. For us as international organizations, for instance, as a UK bank, for instance, we are under, you know, obligations not to pay any bribes. The UK Anti-Bribery Act is there. If I do anything that is detrimental, I actually pay a price. And one of my counterparts, not to be named, was actually fined over $33 million just, 2 weeks ago? About 2 weeks ago, for offering a bribe. So that is the kind of tone that has to be set in order for us to combat corruption.
Yeah, I want to broaden the debate a little bit about corruption, because it goes to the heart of two points I wanted to make on this. First, and it links to the question of infrastructure as well. First, nothing is for free. So someone is footing the bill or whatever failures, leakages there are in policies and in institutions. And this, I think, is inadequately focused on when we discuss. We focus a lot on whether someone actually enriched himself or herself. The question is who paid for it? Because everyone will pass the bill. I'll tell you just one example. When I was in a trade delegation of Sweden at one point, and we met, and Sweden makes trucks, and we figured out that the trucks that they were selling in this African country was 70% more expensive than when they were sold to Swedish customers. And this is completely logical from a business perspective because the purchasing power is lower, so you price differentiate. They can charge more of the suites and charge less there. So we asked them why. And they said, well, it's very simple. Well, first, they are not allowed to pay bribes, so that's not the question because they are liable in Swedish courts. The question, however, was the enforcement of contracts. So there's a 20% failure rate of contracts, and they can't rely on the court system to uphold the contracts, meaning they're passing that loss over to the other customers because they're going to recover the cost. And that brings me to the second point, which is the need to focus in whatever you do in a development journey and whatever development plan you have, less on individual projects or individual business actors and more on the rule of law and institution in a non-discriminatory way. And that's actually very interesting with WTO. That's an institution that deals basically with economic rules of law. That's why countries that go through the accession to WTO go through this steel bath, as we call it, to revisit all the laws from the point of view whether it's transparent, due process, and non-discriminatory. Very good basic principles for law. So I think what I would like to broaden the debate, and there I must say donor community has failed as well. They have, with the Millennium Development Goals, they focus much, much more on the health sector, which is a laudable case. It's very good to do that. But we've seen a reduction in the focus on building institutions, including economic institutions, for the upholding of rule of law. I think this has to be brought back to the development agenda, particularly if we want to meet the SDGs. And that includes for infrastructure. It's not only about whether the government would have the resources, how much is the leakage, but also to think about how do I create the right environment for private investors, domestic or international, to actually invest in that infrastructure. And for that, you have to work on a level playing field based on law.
Thank you. Thank you very much. My name is Betty Miner. For 11 years, I ran a business association in Kenya, the Association of Manufacturers. When we started, and I was going to say this, when I started work, we were just concluding the East African Customs Union. And there was a lot of fear about whether that project would lead to gains for businesses or it would lead to losses. I'd like to say that after 11 years, one thing is that we've seen regional trade grow. We've seen regional production grow. True, there are many containers that come from outside the continent, but increasingly those containers are of raw materials that are refashioned and sold, not just in East Africa, but outside, so that the largest trading partner for the East African countries are their own partners, as well as the rest of the continent. So there is increasing production. I agree with Ali that we would like it faster. But I think it would be wrong to leave this room with the suggestion that we're going backwards. I think we're not going as fast as we'd like, but the point is there is progress, and the integration project has made a difference. But the second thing that I think why we are not making as fast progress as we would is two things. First, it's, I think, the quality of institutions and the transformation of the same. I think in the panel that we were in earlier on, Negatu talks about the fact that there's no need. We are getting infrastructure. We're getting roads, and our own results show that truck turnaround time is increasing. But we're getting the trucks to the border faster, but then they stay for 2 days or 3 days as you sort out the standards and the rules. So I think if focusing on issues on trade facilitation are critical. And it isn't that governments haven't signed on to them. It is the fact that there are people who make some little money from those delays, the petty corruption. So we need to focus on electronic systems and other transformations of our own trade processes in order to realize and in order to encourage businesses to continue investing. But I'd like to, at least for me, from what I've observed, I have seen East African companies even expand, including trading and expanding their trade and exporting to other parts. So I don't think it is doom and gloom. These processes are working for us. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Betty Miner. Good job. Okay, there's another young lady in the back, I think, with a question or a comment. Was there a young lady there? Or yeah?
So,
All right, you go ahead. You go ahead.
Okay, it's good that you have started touching about the youth. So my question is...
give us your name, please.
Oh, okay. I'm Sainaki Protich from the Technical University of Kenya. So when you're talking about the youths and the rise in Africa, what are the tangible compliments that you can say that you have done? And if yes, you are doing something, what are the actions you can show about that one? If no, about the issue, when will you start being involved in the involving the youths in the rising of Africa? Okay. And what are the expectations you have from the youths in the shaping Africa, that is the making it rise? What do you expect from them? Okay, thank you.
Okay, Ali, tangible pluses and expectations.
Look, this is not a question for us here to answer. The young people of Africa are already shaping the continent, to be honest. You cannot be 80% of the population and not be shaping that population. The question is, do we like what we see? Do we like the shape that Africa is taking? There are some who will tell you that Africa is getting better. There are some skeptics like me who worry that it's not getting better fast enough, that we are going to get caught up in our own mess and things are going to get worse. Doesn't mean that I'm not positive. It's just that I think we can push ourselves a bit harder. Now, as for the young people, and in Africa, it's very interesting how we define young, because I think we are the only continent still where people of age 35 are considered young. We don't move out of our parents' home until we get married, and some of us don't get married, so we stay in our houses. So I think that we need to get our act together. We need to become more self-sufficient, more independent, get out of our homes early, set up business, do something. There is no government in Africa that's going to create jobs for its youth. Let me tell you this. Don't even expect that there is, with all the best intentions, I'm going to give you some numbers. Tanzania and Kenya's populations are similar, and I think the production of young people is almost similar. A World Bank report last year showed that close to a million young people every year join the job market. Now, what is the size of the formal workforce in Tanzania? 2.4 million people. We are adding a million every year, and this number is going to grow exponentially. Do you think that there is any capacity in the private sector, in the formal sector, to create jobs for these young people? And what's worse, these million people who join the labor market by virtue of organic growth, that is age, are not necessarily ready to get to take the jobs even if they were given these jobs, because most of them have not benefited from a good education. They just grew like trees. See what I mean? So we are going to have to innovate our way out of this. No government is going to do it, no private. You are the private sector. You are the government, you young people. You're going to have to start creating your own jobs. And I can see many are creating jobs in the entertainment space. Nollywood in Nigeria is employing, I'm told, directly and indirectly, 10 million people already. These are people who don't even get any government support, but they are creating employment. In Kenya, ICT innovation has created hundreds of thousands of jobs already. These are not created by governments. So instead of asking, what are you going to do, tell us what you're doing and how we can help, how we can maybe invest our little savings in what you're doing. But I don't think that we have the answers to that question. That's me. I'm skeptical again.
I think the real question is, Ali, what would Magufuli do?
Put them to work.
David Irungu, real quick, before I ask you gentlemen to summarize and give us some final thoughts. David, how many people do you employ in all your companies? Let's in Africa alone. Just give us a number in Africa. And what percentage is youth?
So today we have 1,600 people worldwide, 1,400 are in Africa, and in our company, I would put it at 75% are people who make me feel very, very old.
So if you want a job, keep Rotich. If you want a job, talk to Irungu afterwards, okay? We'll get you a job. How old are you? 13. Irungu says he's going to need some ID, okay, if you don't mind. Yeah. All right, gentlemen, we're going to start with you, Stefano, and go all the way to Ali, asking you for some final thoughts going forward. Go ahead, Stefano.
Well, very simply, I think that we are here because there's a ministerial conference starting tomorrow afternoon, and I think it's very relevant to the economic situation of this country and this continent, and I think that developing countries have an absolutely crucial role to play in this institution that's called the WTO, because they represent the vast majority of its members, and they need to ensure that it keeps moving forward in its capacity to liberalize trade globally and to make effective rules for the trade of today and the trade of tomorrow. And unless this institution is able to do that with the backing of its members, then I think that we're all shooting ourselves in the foot, and we are moving into a world of trade blocks where I think circumstances for businesses and for smaller countries that are not part of these trade blocks are going to be much, much more difficult.
Thank you. Go ahead, David.
I'll address just 2 points. I know corruption was a hot one, and for me, corruption, the question is the tone enough? It's not. To me, it's the tone and the doing. We need to do more, not just talk about it. That's for Africa. And number two, what do I see as moving Africa ahead? Today, we have the traditional businesses. I don't believe that is what is going to move Africa. It's more innovative things that are going to move Africa. What I believe is that the government needs to start shaping policy, and we are happy to influence that policy to make sure that there are more incentives for people who are investing in IT space, in telecommunication. Today, when you come to Kenya, you don't talk about a manufacturing company most of the time. You talk about a telecommunication company, which in the year 2000, nobody would have talked about telecommunication in Kenya. So that's where we need to go. Thank you.
Thank you, David. Lamin.
Thank you. I think I'll just touch on regional integration. The statistics show that the EU, trade within the EU is about 80% of the trade that takes place. Within Asia, it's about 60% of trade is within the bloc, whereas in Africa, it's only 10%. Only 10% of trade is within Africa. East African community has done relatively well. I think Betty Miner is very right that relative to other blocks, the EAC has done quite well, but there's still a lot that can be done. And I think the private sector is very critical in driving that integration and in making sure that the policymakers are taking the right policy decisions to facilitate that trade. Again, back to East Africa, there's an East Africa Business Council that is actually integral to the regional integration effort to make sure that the voice of the private sector is actually heard and influences policy making. That is the way forward.
Thank you, Lamin. Joachim.
Final thought. Is Africa making money from trade, and has it in the past? Well, actually, yes. It had double-digit trade growth by the commodity exporting countries. The problem was that money was not invested in a manner that allowed for the building of productive capacity and the diversification of the economy. Now the world is in a completely different state, which means that it's much tougher to make easy money, say, from resource rents, which means the importance of being more ambitious for yourself nationally, regionally, as well as addressing the roadblocks for your trade growth globally, where others are sort of preventing you from capturing the benefits on trade, is all the more important. When the world was booming up to the financial crisis, a lot of African countries made a lot of money. That's not the case today. There is not going to be easy cash around. So it's all about the homework.
Wonderful. Last but not least, Ali.
Oh, just a simple message for our ministers, African ministers, and other leaders who are going to be involved in the conversations over the next few days, that maybe now is the time we really need to get smart about this whole negotiation business and understand that there is no shortcut to fair trade. There is no language that you are going to use to convince others
to reduce their advantage to benefit you, you have to have muscle. You have to have a right to be there in that room to negotiate. And the only way to get there is by increasing your productivity. If you want to have a say over the price of cotton, over the price of coffee, control 20% of global production. Everybody's going to listen to you. But if you control 1% and you want to dictate or tell people about what fair price is for you, I think you are wasting time. If you look at the example of OPEC, before OPEC, those countries producing oil around the world were being pushed around and being paid whatever it is that the buyers wanted to pay. It's only when they got together and combined their production, they were able to negotiate the prices with the most powerful people in the world. Today, they are being threatened with the loss of that power because there are other sources of energy and other sources of oil and gas, and they are going to lose that power. And I don't think that Africa is enjoying a very special place or dispensation opportunity here. We have to increase our productivity. We have to have more to sell to be able to have a say in how much it's going to cost. We have to have more to transport, to ship, to be able to negotiate our transportation costs. Everything comes when you have earned it. You cannot just beg and plead for it. That's all I'm saying. So, but this conversation we should have with one another as Africans, not necessarily in those rooms with everybody else, because they may be saying, what the hell do Africans want?
With those very powerful thoughts there, Ali, I'd like you all to join me in thanking my entire distinguished panel here. Yeah. Let me mention them by name. Stefano Bertazzi, David Irungu, Lamine Manjang, Joachim Reiter, and Ali Mafuruki. Thank you so much, gentlemen. Appreciate it. And by the way, we were expecting the Zambian Minister for Commerce and Trade, and she didn't show up. It's a she. It's not just a male-dominated panel. We were going to have a woman, and Betty Mwangi, at least you stepped in. So, final thoughts, ladies and gentlemen. As you continue to tweet, by the way, there's a great tweet here that just came in. Let me just read it. And by the way, the Twitter handle is at ICTSD. And trademark East Africa, listen to this. The true wealth of Africa is not what is beneath the ground, but what is in our minds. Remember that. As I tell you my final thoughts, which are basically my favorite movie all time, one of my favorite movies, is a movie called Field of Dreams, starring Kevin Costner, James Earl Jones. Great movie about baseball in America, but also it's about life. And throughout this movie, a voice keeps coming in and out, saying the same thing, saying the words, if you build it, they will come. If you build it, they will come. If we build the infrastructure, if we build the institutions, if we build the policy frameworks, they will come and we will build this continent. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. You've been a great audience. Appreciate it. Well done.